later today in Daytime Live with the musical Return to the Forbidden Planet. Also, we meet the great-granddaughter of a Turkish sultan, and Howard Stableford will beam down from tomorrow's world. So join us, roller skating robot and all, at 12:05.
9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, ignition!
And welcome. Today we boldly go where no BBC television show has ever gone before with a cult musical, Return to the Forbidden Planet.
I'll be talking to a woman who traced her mother's life story back to a sultan's palace.
And from tomorrow's world, Howard Stableford will be indulging in a personal passion. That's all to come on our Interplanetary Daytime Live.
Or perhaps I ought to say lift-off of the musical Return to the Forbidden Planet, which is building up a large and devoted following among audiences of all ages. It's a mix of Shakespeare and Dan Dare and Dan Air, I suppose, all set to the music of classical pop songs from the 50s and 60s. So, no, it's not written by Andrew Lloyd Webber. Later on, we're going to be following the mission to the Forbidden Planet with another couple of numbers from the show, but first of all, let's meet the man behind the show, Bob Carlton. And Bob, you're actually not only behind the show, you wrote it, directed it, had the whole idea in the first place. And I met you 7 years ago called Nationwide, which people might dimly remember, for the first production.
Yes.
So it's come a long way in 7 years.
Indeed, we were doing it in a park then, in a big tent. And you gave me a four-leaf clover as good luck. And here we are in the West End. It's great.
I'm glad to play a small part in your achievement. But it was, yes, the West End. It's amazing for started out as community theatre.
That's right.
It's now no big stars, but there it is, a hit. West End success.
That's right, it's a company show. I mean, it's the whole company are the stars of the show. It's been a great thrill.
Where do you get the original idea from? It's a mixture of Shakespeare and 50s and 60s music and all sorts of things.
Well, the Bubble Theatre were a company of actor musicians, and we'd done some straight Shakespeare's, using actor musicians. And then in the evenings, as a late night thing, we used to get some old rock and roll together that we liked and play. And one year we put together a story to link that, and it was the story of Macbeth, all done in cod, iambic pentameters and misquotes of Shakespeare. And the next year we decided to do a full-length idea behind the show. I'd seen the film, the MGM film, Forbidden Planet, when I was a kid, and realised that one of the reasons it was so successful is it nicked the story of The Tempest. So that's what we all did. We went back to The Tempest and redid it.
So you end up with this amazing combination. The audience were loving all the different lines from Shakespeare.
That's right.
Bent round. But there's a lovely rapport coming off the stage with the cast. How long have they all been together?
Well, I think the core of us have been together about 10 years now, and it don't seem a day too long. gradually other people have accrued, and that's the company that's doing it. And it's the energy, really, that they give out on stage, which I think makes the show such a success.
They all play different instruments, and they understudy for each other's parts. You really get a feeling of togetherness.
That's right.
There are some splendid special effects in there.
Yes, we were very lucky. Originally we did our own special effects, which were awful tabletop animations. But when we were coming into the West End, we were asked who we wanted to do them. And the obvious person really was Gerry Anderson. We never thought we'd get him. But we put the idea to him, and he thought it was fabulous.
And tell me about Gerry Anderson. He's a very famous actor.
Oh, it's like meeting your childhood when you meet Gerry Anderson. He worked very hard on them. And the thing was that we wanted it to be a very B-movie effects. So when he set it all up, I mean, none of the strings showed. And I had to ask him if he could make the strings show. And he'd spent 30 years trying to disguise them. And I was asking him to show them.
Is it wonderful? A monster, you had a monster and planets everywhere.
Yeah,
and
that's right.
It was fantastic. Yeah. The audience at the beginning, I thought, were very sort of staid. We all sat in our seats and we were all very like this. And the cast come out among the audience at the beginning and point the ray guns at us all and tell us about, you know, safety regulations and so on. And everybody was looking very staid. And by the end, these most unlikely people were standing up, clapping and smiling and bopping in the aisles. I wondered, you know, how do you know why this transformation takes place?
Well, I think it's rock and roll, really. It gets you going that way. I mean, one of the things I always wanted to do was, because I liked theatre and liked rock and roll, I wanted to do a show that had the same sort of effect at the end as a rock and roll concert. And I think that's what we've done. And it is nice to see very sort of staid people at the start of the show, trying to find out what it's about. And then coming back to see it again and bringing hairdryers as ray guns to zap the monster and get them out of the handbags. You know.
Plugs and all.
That's right, yes.
Wonderful. Well, we wish you a lot of luck. Well, after the Cambridge Theatre in London, does it move on somewhere else?
Well, we're playing at the Cambridge until people stop coming. And then I hope there's tours and there's talk of America and Australia and things. So I hope something more comes of it, yes.
It's very different from Andrew Lloyd Webber, but I hope it's going to be just as successful.
Thank you very much.
Well, Bob, thank you very much indeed. And we're going to, as I said, hear a couple more numbers. So let's rejoin our interplanetary space flight. And as the atmosphere gets thinner, the plot thickens.
Vouchsafe to those that can't follow the story that I may prompt them. And of such as can, I humbly pray them to admit the excuse of time, of numbers, and of due course of things, which cannot in their huge and proper life be here presented. Now, lest our tale jar, let me relate the story thus so far. A spaceship on a routine survey flight has been drawn to a planet by a force. Upon it, Dr. Prospero, the same as all the world thought had defected, lives, working upon a mind-expanding drug. And now his daughter, a beauteous lass, has fallen for the captain of this ship. But will this self-same captain share her love? Let's see.
But soft, what light from yonder airlock breaks?
It is my daughter, sir.
Jeepers, what a hum. I love the colorful clothes she wears and the way the sunlight plays upon her hair. I hear the sound of her gentle word on the wind that lifts her perfume through the air.
I'm picking up the vibrations she's giving me. She's giving me
shuttlecraft. There are yet missing of this company. Go, search it out and bring it hither straight.
I don't know where, but he sends me there.
My, what a sensation. My, what a lay show. My, what a...
Captain, may I present my little girl? Miranda, say hello.
That is a spirit.
No, wench. It eats and sleeps and hath such senses as we have such. Woman, Captain, I pray you, mark my words, is no more than a common saboteur. My great new science, telegenesis, could have transformed mankind, created things by impulses from power of brain alone. Consider, friends, the good this could perform. An end to conflict, famine, and disease.
Oh, brave new world that could be rid of these.
And she... this panacea would destroy.
We shall not spend a large expense of time before we reckon with her several crimes. But this is just a temporary reprieve. Until that time, up duty, you're relieved. And to this end, a few words, Dr. Pree. Robot, take her below. Lock her away.
Elmet by starlight, proud Gloria. I'll manacle your feet together.
No. I will resist such entertainment till mine enemy has more power.
Come, obey! So, who's sorry now? Nunnery. Right to the end. Just like a friend. I tried to warn you somehow. But did she listen? Did she buckle out? You had your way. Well, now you must pay.
Sorry, adjective. Regretful, apologetic, full of grief or sorrow, compunctious, conscience, bitten, curse one's folly, lament, repent, dismal or pining, expressing pity, pained at heart, contemptible, vile, worthless, wretchedly bad, little account or value. Noun, sorriness, adverb, sorrowly, comparative, sorriest, superlative, sorriest. In other words, sorry.
You're so sorry now.
Will the spaceship ever get home? Will the captain finally get the girl? Will you manage to get a ticket before they're all sold out? Find out this and more at the Cambridge Theatre, London, England, in Return to the Forbidden Planet!
You shake my nerves and you rattle my brain. Too much love drives a man insane. You broke my will, what a thrill.
Goodness gracious, great balls of fire. Shake my mind, love is fire. Goodness gracious, great balls of fire. Kiss me, baby. Oh, that feels good. Hug me, baby. I wanna love you like a lover should. You're fine, so fine. Gotta show the world that you're mine, all mine. I chew my nails and I drill my bone. I'm getting another.
off my well. But oh, what a thrill. Goodness gracious, great balls of fire. Sure. You're fine, so fine. Gotta show the world that you're mine, all mine. I chew my nails and I twirl my balls. I'm really nervous, but this sure is fun. You broke my will. Goodness gracious, great balls of fire.